Hey everybody, today I'm going to go over lesson 12 in the Adobe Photoshop Classroom in a Book for 2024, and that's retouching a portrait in Camera Raw. This is going to be part two of our final tutorial in Raster Imaging this semester. So let's get started. Okay, so here I have Photoshop opened. I'll choose File, Open, go to my computer, navigate to my lesson 12 folder, and open 12B start.nef. I'll have that uploaded to Blackboard for you. So when you open a raw file, you'll see this Camera Raw application open. This is actually a separate application from Photoshop itself, but comes with Photoshop. And in Camera Raw, we can do the bulk of our editing. In fact, if we're only making kind of basic edits or standard edits, you might be able to do your entire workflow in Camera Raw and output directly from there. So here we see this bride picture in Camera Raw. I want to quickly mention that Camera Raw has a new capability to do what it calls enhance a photograph. To see the enhance capability, I'll roll over onto the image thumbnail here in the film strip and click on the three dots. Then I'll click enhance. And what that does is Enhance uses AI to improve image quality. The result will be saved as a new DNG. Super resolution doubles the image resolution, ideal for large displays and prints. I've found this useful, especially when I get smaller images, to just give me enough to be able to work with. So here we see her eye, for example, without the enhancement, and then with the enhancement. So you may or may not want to use the enhance tool. I'll go ahead and click enhance here and you'll see what happens. The progress bar is going through and now we have a new image. It's created a new image for us. This new image is now 5,664 by 8,512 pixels, resulting in a 48.2 megapixel file at 300 pixels per inch. Our original image is 2,832 pixels by 4,256 pixels for a file size of 12.1 megapixels at 300 pixels per inch. So you see how much larger the enhance tool can make your image without necessarily degrading its quality. For our exercise today, we're going to use the original image, and so I'll choose mark for deletion, and this image will then be shown as moving to the trash. So here we are back on our original image that is 2,832 by 4,256 pixels. My first stop is to just click auto and see what happens to the image. You can see here, I'll click on the zoom tool and zoom in a little bit here on her face. So let's turn auto off, kind of gray, flat looking. We turn on auto and we see kind of her face pop. See what happened up here to the histogram as we change it. See how everything moved down towards the darker end, shifted everything more equitably throughout the image by clicking auto. For the profile, I'm going to choose Adobe Portrait, which will adjust the colors in a way that should enhance a portrait image. So yeah, it looks like it took a little bit of the saturation out right there. Then we need to click auto again. Now a little richer. Let's zoom out a little bit here from this image. And when we talk about white balance, you might see when we look at this, it looks like it has a kind of green cast, greenish yellow here in her dress. You can see it kind of in her hair. And in order to adjust that greenish cast, I'll open up the color menu here on the right-hand side. And next to white balance, I'll pick the eyedropper tool. And we'll roll over here into her dress and maybe pick a part that we think that we want to tell Photoshop is white. You see how much more orange it became when we chose that particular shade. I'm going to press Command Plus here so we can zoom in a little bit. And so I want to find a good white part of her dress in here that actually all of this looks pretty good. You know, all the details, we haven't lost anything. We haven't lost any detail in here. Most all of her embroidery on the dress is still visible. We do have, you know, it's hot in here, right? Very bright. And so it's really helpful to be able to see what changes we've made. And if you come down here to this little icon at the bottom, the cycles between before and after views, I'll click on that square and we can see kind of what changed, what we've changed in this image since we started out. You see that kind of greenish color cast? No, not in here. Green on her skin. Give her that kind of orangey, yellower look. It's much nicer picture. A lot more lively. So that's looking pretty nice. I'll go ahead and cycle through these, the different varieties of before and after you can look at. And there we are back to the regular view. Command zero. We'll get the whole image onto my screen. Looks very nice. Here we go, just for a peek. Before and after. Let's go ahead and hide the film strip because we don't need it open with just one image. And that allows us then to take up the whole space and be able to better see what we're working on. We've set the auto changes. We have the Adobe Portrait profile selected. We can make other changes to the image depending on our own preferences or, you know, client requests. These are the values that were calculated by the auto choice. We might adjust the exposure, obviously too much, to make her a little brighter. We might change the contrast to make it make our edges a little sharper or not, right? Maybe we don't want so much detail. So I'll dial that back to about 20. Highlights will brighten up the highlights, as might make sense. Shadows can either deepen or minimize our shadows. Somewhere in there looks good. You can adjust all of these to your taste. Dial down the whites or dial them up. See the changes that I'm making in the histogram as well. And then we can move the blacks or make them and do more with them. Yeah, my taste is for bright, saturated, contrasty images. And so that's kind of where I go. Before, after. This is our original image. This is our adjusted image entirely in camera raw. And now we can start to work on retouching the bride's skin. So let's go ahead and press Command plus plus to zoom in some on her face. And over here on the right-hand side in the control panel, I'll choose this remove tool, and then we'll choose the healing brush in that remove tool. That's the little Band-Aid looking one. So what we can do here is use the space bar to make a hand and scroll around. She's got a little like crumb on her chest here. And I will use the left square bracket to make this brush smaller. That's the left square bracket on my keyboard, which is on the right-hand side of the keyboard about three rows down. Here on the tools option menu, we can change the size of the brush. You want it to be about the size of the whatever you're trying to cover up, and the feather. What that means is the feathering creates the edge. So we'll go with 100% here. And there we go. We've covered up that crumb that was on her chest. When we are using this healing brush, we can use different methods to do the healing. Heal calculates a healing mode. Clone literally copies other parts. You can experiment with these to kind of see what's happening. There's a crease here, and I'll just kind of brush down this, right, to make some of these lines go away. I'll choose heal, do kind of the same thing. And so experiment, try different tools, different modes. You can see what just happened when I clicked heal here on this mark on her neck. It doesn't quite do what we want it to do, does it? So let's try. I can also click show overlay, which will allow me to see where the change is going to be and where the source is being calculated to heal it. Okay, that looks better. And so as we can go through and remove whichever marks that we like. But be sensitive as you are retouching someone's face. Go with what the client would like from you, especially when you're removing significant things like maybe jewelry or, you know, any kind of marks on their face. We'll give her nose ring back. I'll press undo. There we go. Oops. Oh yeah, we'll go ahead and take that out. It's a little nose hair peeking out there. Take it. Right? Much better. Okay. Command zero gets the whole thing on screen again. Touched up her face a little bit. And now we'll get into masking. Masking works the same here as it does in Photoshop proper. So we'll click on the masking icon over here on the right-hand side, and we get this new masking options menu. You can see that the computer is finding people in the photo. And there we have person one. This will be using the generative AI tools. And what we can do is create masks based on, you know, identified parts of the person. So let's choose facial skin and create that mask. Now, because we have this part of the model masked out, the changes that we make will only affect this part of the image. So for example, we could change the exposure on just her face, contrast, highlights, shadows, etc. We can change the texture of her skin to be softer or more harsh, right? So we'll just dial down that texture a little bit to make it slightly subtle. You want to be careful when you're dialing texture and clarity back and forth, right? That's way too much. So let's see. This is before, after. Just softening things, but not taking away the texture altogether. Can use the haze. I don't think that's one we want to use. And then diminish the grain or increase it. Just take it down a little bit. So again, this is our change. This is before the change. Using that automated mask and the variety of options in here that you all can experiment with. We can change the curves, meaning the color specifically on her face to enhance different details or create some dramatic effect. Undo. And so now we've made some changes to the facial skin. Now let's create a new mask and just use the brush to apply it. Here, my brush is much too big, so I'll use my left square bracket, again, on the right-hand side of the keyboard to make it smaller. Down, 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 much smaller. And here we have our brush size, our brush feather, flow, and density. So we'll make the size into 2. Feather is 100, meaning it'll be a very wide feather, not a sharp edge at all. Flow is 50, meaning the brush applies half of the paint with each stroke. And density will be 100, and auto mask will be unchecked. We'll scroll on down to color, and under saturation, we'll bump that up to about 70. And now I'll paint that over the eyes, paint this mask. Paint it over her lips. And let's see if you can see that slight change in saturation that I've painted over her lips and eyes to make them pop out a little bit. And so here we can come up to mask one and double click on it and call it eyes and lips. Choose OK. We can turn that mask on and off. And we can roll our cursor over here onto the thumbnail itself to see what we had covered with it. So actually, I could see there that I didn't have my whole lips covered. Let's see. That's better. And just to make this more extreme, I'll show you. Turn off the mask, turn it on. 100% saturation. You can see how the kind of feathering edge works here where it's thickest sort of in the middle. If you can see that kind of color change in the lips right there. But we don't see a hard edge, which was the goal. If you click Show Overlay, it'll do the same thing that it did when we were hovering our mouse cursor over eyes and lips. So now when I click Show Overlay, it'll give us that view that will show us where exactly you're applying the mask to, where the edges are and what those look like. So I'm just using that to make sure I get all of my eyes and all of my lips in here. Turn it off, and I'll go ahead and let you see these changes. That's after before, right? I just saturated the lips and the eye color a little bit with a mask. And then after you're satisfied with your changes there, go ahead and click on this mask one, and I'll call this eyes and lips, right? Always name your layers, always name your adjustments, because you'll get mixed up. So here's our before, here's our after. I'll go ahead and press Command-0 so we can see where we're at. Go back to the adjustment tool so we can have a better look. Turn off the film strip again. Lovely. So this is where we started, and this is where we finished. We might take another filter and smoother skin in here, right? Go ahead and work on some hair and things like that. But that covers the basic changes and adjustments that you can make to a portrait in Adobe Camera Raw. Now that we're satisfied with our adjustments on this image, I can go ahead and click Done, which will save it with these changes and that XMP sidecar file that tells Photoshop what it looks like. And if I want to make additional changes that I can't do in Camera Raw, I could click Open, and then it would open in Photoshop, which I'll do now. Here we are, the same image in Photoshop. Or if I'd like to share this image with someone, I could click on the Save Options button here, and choose save in same location and change it to, let's say, document name. That's great. And change the format to, for example, a JPEG so that we can send it out perhaps to a client or someone else that we want to share the image with. Scroll down through these options. All of that looks great. You could choose resize to fit. That would mean to make the image smaller. In this case, for example, they probably don't need the entire 12 megapixel image to just review it. So in this case, I might resize it to go in an email and say, does this look like a good adjustment? So all of that looks good. It's going to be named 12bstart.jpg and save in my Photoshop CIB 24 lessons, lesson 12 folder. Save. I can click done and we are through. Then in my lesson 12 folder, I can see that image that I just output. If I press command I, it'll show me that it is 800 pixels by 532 pixels in dimension, which is what I had told Photoshop to save it as. So that is what you will do to complete this exercise in Blackboard, is make your changes to this image or another image of your choice that you open in Camera Raw and retouch yourself. Again, we would choose destination, wherever you want to save it at on your computer, document name, file extension will be JPEG in this case, .jpg. When you choose that file extension, it will change the format to JPEG. And please do choose resize to fit. 800 pixels in the long dimension will be a fine size to submit to Blackboard. And when that is done, I'll grade it and you will have learned something new about using Camera Raw to retouch portraits in Photoshop. Thanks for watching.